Someone told me there were 728 people in the theatre when we did it, and 73 million people watching. So you think I'm nervous on these shows? No way, man. I had to sing yesterday live in front of all those people.
February 9th, 1964. The Beatles on Ed Sullivan. I remembered. Sorry, girls, he's married under John.
It was very exciting, you can imagine, you know. We didn't really know who Ed Sullivan was till we got over here. But I think that was part of the fun, really.
And it probably spawned so many rock bands that started today from watching that show, you know, picking up instruments.
What appeals to you about the Beatles?
And the fact that they're British and that they're very talented without knowing how to read a word of music. And they have a good sense of humor. They're ordinary boys. And I think they're very nice from what I've heard on the radio.
I mean, the nice thing is I still get people coming up to me now and sort of, they've got a memory of where they were when that happened, you know. They like to say, well, I was at home, I was 10 years old, and my dad walked out the room.
I like the Beatles.
You don't care if your parents like it or not.
Nope. We love the Beatles.
I remember different pieces of it. I remember the arrows on the stage when they first came out, all the screaming.
Most Americans have got some memory of that. So it's an honor, really, you know, that they remember you so well from that show. Wow. You ready for this, then? Okay, here we go. Cinema Verite, speaking to you from a dressing room in the Ed Sullivan Theater. Many years later, ready to rumble. Let's do it, dude!
Ready?
Where do you go?
We're starting off with 20 Flight Rock, and it's the song that got me into the Beatles. Because I met John when I was, about 15 or something, I think. Pretty young. A friend of mine took me along to what was called the Wilton Village Fete, which is like a garden party. And John was performing there with the band he had at the time, so I kind of first met him. And then during the day, we went backstage at the Wilton Church kind of thing, and we were hanging out because they were going to play in the evening as well, so they had a break. So we were hanging out backstage, and I did a little bit of Little Richard stuff, which I was into, and then I borrowed a guitar, and because I'm left-handed, I had to turn it upside down, but a mate of mine had a guitar, so I knew how to do that. And I just sang 20 Flight Rock, you know, and they were really impressed that I knew the words. I mean, that was like it, you know, if you knew the words. And a couple of days later, I was out on my bike and one of the guys in the group cycled up to me and said, hey, they want you to join the group, man. I said, what? I said, well, I've got to think about it, you know, because I didn't know whether I could do that, like whether my dad had let me or whatever, you know, it's a big thing at that age. So I said, why do they want me? He said, well, you knew the words to 20 Flight Rock, man. This is true genius, you know, at work. So that got me in the band, you know, and I've never looked back.
She's a queen to dance on a Saturday night. Alone, I can hold her tight. She lives on 20th floor of town. The elevator's broken down. But I walk 1, 2, flat 3x4, 5, 6, 7, flat 8x1. About 12, I'm starting to sag. 15 before I'm ready to drag. I get to the top, I'm too tired to rock. Where's she going? Up on the telephone, said, come on over, baby, cause I'm all alone. I said, baby, you're mighty sweet. I'm buried aching feet. This went on for a couple of days, but I couldn't stay away. So I walked 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 4. I'm on 12, I'm starting to sag. 15 before I'm ready to drag. I'll get to the top. I'm too tired to rock. I'm too booked to pop it.
sent to Chicago for a pass to speak, stop, use the stairs. I hope they hurry before it's too late. I love my baby too much to wait. All this climbing is getting me down. If I'm a cop straight over the rail, I walk 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. I'm on the 12th, I'm starting to sag. 15 before I'm ready to drag. I'll get to the top, I'm too tired to ride. Too tired, man, I can't handle it. Try to stop me.
Thank you.
What used to happen is you'd record the song, whatever song it was, and you'd then get to do it on stage. The nice thing about me being left-handed, probably the best thing, was that when you get two guys on a mic, if they're right-handed, they bang each other with the guitars. They're both fighting for sort of that space. Whereas with me and George, as it was often doing the things, it'd be like that. I'd be this way, George would be that. It's very convenient. So you're just both moving on a mic. You can get easy on the mic. So that always used to be the thing. And then when we had She Loves You and Twist and Shout, there was this bit where we went, woo, and we did that. And to get a bit of feeling into it, one night we just found that both of us would get excited and we just woo and shook our heads, you know. And all the fans were, ah! And it was like, what do we do? And somebody later said, just shook your heads, you know. That was great. Oh, keep it in then. So that became one of those things that just you thought, well, you know, if we want to laugh, shake your head, you know. So that all grew off the sort of the mic position there, and so that became one of our sort of trademarks. It got embarrassing, actually. We knocked it on the head after a while because it got to be too silly, you know. But for a little while there, it was a guaranteed way to get a scream, shake your head.
We'll be right back with more Paul McCartney up close.
Penny Lane is a place in Liverpool. Literally, it is a bus depot. When John and I were writing songs later, we often used to just hark back to places that we both remembered, you know.
In Penny Lane, there is a bar showing photographs of every head he's had the pleasure to know, and all the people that come and go stop and say hello. With a motor car, a little children laughing him behind his back, and the banker never wears a mask in the pouring rain. Very strange. Penny Lane is in my ears and in my eyes. There beneath the blue suburban skies, I sit. Penny Lane, there was a fireman with an hourglass, and in his pocket is a portrait of the Queen. He likes to keep his fire engine clean. It's a clean machine. A pretty nurse is telling puppies from a tray. Though she feels as if she's in a play, she is anywhere. In Penny Lane, the barber shaves another customer. We see the banker sitting waiting for the trim. Then the fireman rushes in from the pouring rain. Very strange.
This song is off the new album again. This song is called Biker Like an Icon.
Yeah.
to follow him across America on the biker, just like her. She didn't care, she still persisted. The Warner Brothers said she was twisted, and the family said they wouldn't miss her anyway. She loved her biker like an icon, gazing at his feature every day. She loved her biker like an icon, slowly watching precious drift away. She tried her best to fix a meeting. She pulled it off one night in Hollywood. When he met her, he couldn't let her get away.
He didn't ask for her permission, took advantage of her position, but she was always her ambition anyway. She loved her biker like an icon, gazing at his picture every day. Yeah, she loved her.
So hard to find her, they showed a picture across America, but no trace of her sweet face was ever found. She loved her biker like an icon, gazing at his picture every day. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, she loved her biker like an icon, slowly watching prisoners.
So something like biker came very quickly. Some of them just throw themselves onto the page. Paperback writer was another. Remember, you know, showing up at John's house and saying, we could have a song kind of like this, like it's a letter. I just wrote out a letter. He said, that's it. So biker was a bit like that. I was very lucky, you know, it just came easily and threw itself onto the page. Some of them take a bit longer. Some of them, like yesterday, I dreamed the melody of that and took about 2 weeks to find good words for it. Because the original words were, scrambled eggs. Oh my baby, how I love your legs. Which wouldn't have quite been suitable.
Okay, so that'll do for the little
space
thing, I think. Let's do a bit of acoustic stuff.
We used to be, still am, a big fan of Chet Atkins. And this finger-picking thing Chet used to do was very big with the guys in Liverpool, because you had to be able to play guitar to do what he did. Everyone else could thrash around and, you know, bebop a lula or something, but you had to know what you were doing. And there were only a couple of guys in Liverpool who could do it. So this was kind of slightly my version of this sort of finger-picking, with a little bass line, a little tune on the top. And what I used to use it for was, we used to get invited to these very artsy parties, and we weren't really artsy. We were kind of working class boys, you know. But John was at art college, so we'd go along to one of the tutors, you know, do's, and we'd be a little bit out of our element. We'd be enjoying it, but the people there would be sort of, you know, painters or symphony conductors or something. It was all, and we'd be a little bit the scruffs, you know. So one of the things, I used to occasionally take a guitar and sort of sit in the corner looking very enigmatic and French, and so, with a black polo neck and sort of, and just hope some of the birds would go, wow, he's a French guy, you know, must get to meet him. So they never did. So anyway, I had the tune, and years later, John said, remember that silly French thing you used to do? I said, yeah. He said, well, you should put words to that, you know. So I did.
Michel, my bell, these are words that go together well. My Michel, Michel, my bell, sans les mots qui vont très bien ensemble, I love you, I love you, I love you, that's all I wanna say, until I find a way, I will say the only words I know that you understand. Michel, my bell, sans les mots qui vont très bien ensemble, très bien ensemble. Well, I need to, I need to, I need to, I need to make you see what you mean to me, and until I do, I'm hoping you will know what I mean. I love you. Well, I want you, I want you, I want you. I think you know by now I'll get to you somehow, but until I do, I'm telling you so you'll understand. Michel, ma belle, sans les mots qui vont très bien ensemble, très bien ensemble, and I will say the only words I know that you understand, my Michel. Yes, I will say the only words I know that you understand, my Michel. Oh, ho, 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 ho.
Thank you very much. Cheers. Okay, moving right along. We are now going to sing a song which is going to be our new single off the new album. And this one is called Hope of Deliverance.
We live in hope. Oh.
Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Stay tuned for more Paul McCartney up close.
I Want to Be Your Man. Well, that was originally written for Ringo. Because on the early Beatles albums, you know, all the guys had their own pockets of fans. You know, there'd be George fans, Ringo fans, John fans, and Paul fans. And there was always quite a legion of Ringo fans. You know, they just love Ringo, you know. So you always thought, well, we can't not have him do a song. And in the early days, he knew a couple of songs he used to do with his previous group. He used to do the Shirelles song called Boys, which is kind of weird, you know. So, yeah, I'm talking about boys. We never thought about boys, girls. It doesn't matter. It's just a good song, you know. I never realized a guy singing a song about boys had implications. You know, what the hell, it doesn't matter. It's just a good song. So, anyway, the album came up, and we had to find a song for Ringo. So John and I generally tried to come up with something. And we came up with I Want to Be Your Man. And Ringo did it on the album. It worked great for him. It's not a very rangy song, and, so he could handle it nicely. And he enjoyed doing it. And then one day, John and I were walking down Charing Cross Road in London in the early 60s. And two guys were going past in a taxi. They shouted at us. And it was Mick and Keith, the Stones, you know, and they were going along this way. So we said, hey, hey, give us a lift, you know. So we bunked into their taxi. And Mick was saying, hey, we've got a recording contract, you know, we're with Decca now. We said, oh, great, congratulations. Because it was a very friendly scene. There's not a lot of rivalry, actually. And, you know, it now seems like there was this bitter feud. The Stones were the dirty, you know, horrible long hairs, and we were the cute, real nice guys. It wasn't like that at all, you know. We were very, very similar in tastes and in clothes and everything. So Mick said, have you got a song? And I said, ding, 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 you know, computer going on. Have we got a song? So I said, well, listen, there's this Ringo song. And I knew they were into Bo Diddley. They did Not Fade Away and stuff like that. We knew they did that stuff, Mick and his maracas, you know. So I said, I know a song. We've got this Ringo song off the album. It's not going to be a single for us, but maybe you guys could take it. So that's what they did. It was their first single, I think.
Be your man. I wanna be your man. I wanna be your man. I wanna be your man.
Sergeant Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band.
Thank you.
And my best memory of the song, though, really, was after we'd recorded it, we got all the artwork together, and we released it on a Friday night, used to release in London. And Brian Epstein had this place called the Savile Theatre, where he used to have shows on a Sunday night, and he'd have people like Chuck Berry, great people, you know, so we'd always go along to see them. There was nothing else happening on a Sunday night. And this Sunday, after the Friday that Pepper was released, Jimi Hendrix was due to play. So, like, you know, I was a good friend of Jimmy's and a really major fan of his, because he was just like a bolt from the blue, you know, amongst guitarists. And I used to go to all his gigs, you know, because he was just there in London, like 10 minutes away, you know. So I went down to the Savile that night. And lo and behold, here comes Jimmy, and he opens with Sgt. Pepper, which he only got released on Friday. So you just open with it, you know, it's just like, all right, you know, that was it, man. That was it. That's my favorite sort of memory of that song. I mean, talk about a compliment.
We'll be right back with more Paul McCartney up close.
Thank you all to join with me and thank this lovely band of mine. On guitar over there, Robbie McIntosh. Next to him on keyboards, Wick Swickin. Over here, for once out of his drum seat, our new drummer, Blair Cunningham. And at the back here, your favorite of mine, Hamish Stewart. And supporting me, as she's always done, Gertrude Higgins. It's really Linda, my wife, but I just say that. Yeah. Thank you very much for having us. See you next time. Bye.